Okay, so what I'm doing here is filling the gap left by Boris Dziga. I'm not at all going to speak about the same subject as I was supposed to do. I just filled the gap. So I cooked up this presentation during the weekend. I don't know if the time is perfectly calibrated, we will see. So I'm going to speak about a joint work with Masaki Kashiwara on the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. We already saw some instances of the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence in this conference. For example, Philip Bolch yesterday mentioned it in a different setting because he was speaking about connections. This is slightly more general. I'm going to speak about D-modules. So the workshop and the school turns around two main subjects. One is maybe Hodge D-modules, the other is infinity structures. Not everybody in the audience, I think, is familiar with D-modules, so I will keep a low level. The paper I'm going to talk about has appeared on the archive, and reference is 13.11.23.74. It is roughly 100 pages because there are some technical things to settle that, of course, I will sweep under the carpet now. But before going into the subject of the paper, let me start from a bit far back. So the classical Riemann-Hilbert problem dates from 1900. It's Hilbert's 21st problem. And Hilbert says that it is a problem that Riemann himself almost surely may have in mind. And that is why it's called the Riemann-Hilbert problem. And the statement that I took from Wikipedia is the following: to show that there always exists a linear differential equation of the Fuchsian class with given singular points and monodromic group. Monodromic group, I would read monodromy. I don't know if it's a translation for the German, but so the idea is that you start with the ODE on the projective line or on the complex plane, and from some data attached to it, namely the singular points and the monodromy, you would like to be able to reconstruct the ODE. Let me recall briefly what's a Fuchsian ODE. An ordinary differential equation, so I take a variable z in the complex plane, I take a linear differential operator with the holomorphic coefficients, and a singular point is a point where the top degree coefficient vanishes, let us say z0, and the Fuchsian condition is a condition on the vanishing order of the coefficients. You need to assume that the order of the top coefficient minus the degree is smaller or equal than the same quantity regarding the other coefficients. And if this condition is satisfied, the solutions of the ODE are very well known. It's a classical result. For example, you know that formal solutions around z0 always converge, and you can be much more precise. You can give an explicit basis of m solutions around the singularity, and the solutions have this form. So there is a ramification, z minus z0 power lambda. Lambda is a complex number, and then there is a convergent series as coefficient, and I sweep under the carpet some logarithmic terms, which are also well known, but I don't want to write down explicitly. So the lambda that appears in each component of the basis contribute to the monodromy of the system of solutions. And so in particular, what we know very well is that if you consider the set of holomorphic solutions of a Fuchsian ODE, then it gives a local system outside of the singular points. I assume they are all Fuchsian. So what does it mean? So to an ODE, you can associate a local system, which means a representation of the fundamental group of the complement of the singular points, and you would like to be able to reconstruct the ODE starting from this data, this datum. Of course, this is not possible. There is a very easy example. You can consider an ODE of order zero, which is just multiplication by something. And there are two very different somethings. So you can consider the equation 1 times u equal to 0, or the equation z times u equal to 0. So these are your possible differential operators. Of course, they are quite different. But if you look at the induced local system, it is exactly the same. It is the trivial local system outside of the origin. So you need to put some extra conditions if you want to reconstruct the ODE, and namely, you need to attach some data to the singularities themselves, and then maybe link the two. And you can do it by considering not only the homogeneous equation P of U equal to zero, but the inhomogeneous equation, and then ask when is it solvable, and things like that. Okay, so the let me generalize a lot this setting. I'm going to several complex variables, and I want to keep track of this kind of problem. And maybe the best way of formulating the Riemann-Lindbergh correspondence, generalizing it to several variables, is by using the theory of D-modules. And the setting is as follows. Take a complex manifold, X, and then consider, denote by dx, the sheaf of rings of linear differential operators. What is it? You simply, let me give a easy description in local coordinates. You take z equal z1 up to zn, a system of local coordinates on x, and then an element of this ring is simply differential operator, which means a finite sum. I use a multi-index notation of some coefficient time holomorphic derivatives with respect to the variables. Okay, so alpha is a multi-index. And these coefficients, as before, as for ODEs, are holomorphic. Okay, then a good idea is to replace ODEs with D-modules, some special kind of D-modules. And because also to a D-module, you can also associate a kind of solutions, which in this terminology is obtained as linear, D-linear morphism from the module itself to O. This is the complex of holomorphic solutions. I already switched to derived categories. There is an R in front of the OM. And it is indeed a generalization of what we were doing on the previous slide, because, for example, if you take a single differential operator, it's annoying. If you take a single differential operator, you can associate to it a cyclic D-module with one generator and the relation given by the operator itself. And then if you compute the zeroth cohomology group of the solution complex written above, you recover exactly the set of holomorphic solutions to the homogeneous equation. And let me mention that if you consider the higher cohomology groups of this complex, these are also very interesting because they, it is related. So Hj of solutions for j bigger than zero is related to what are called algebraic compatibility conditions. For the system of PDEs, which is underlying the module. In this case, I took a single differential operator, but you can take a full system, and then there are some conditions if you want to solve the non-homogeneous equation, and the higher cohomology groups of the solutions encode some abstract algebraic compatibility conditions that you need to impose if you want to have a hope of solving the non-homogeneous system. Okay, so I will explain to you. This is a classical result by Kashiwara. It's very old now. I will explain now why this is a good setting to solve the Riemann-Hilbert problem. You need to generalize things. Instead of considering ordinary differential operators, now we switch to more variables. I already explained that it's a good idea to replace differential operators with D-modules, not any kind of D-modules. They need to have some finiteness condition. They need to be coherent. And if you want to really replace what's an ODE in one variable, you need to add a condition, which is called holonomicity. What's a holonomic D-module? If you think again of a coherent D-module as a system of partial differential equations, you need to add more and more equations so that the solutions become smaller and smaller, and you need to do it as much as you can. Holonomic modules were previously called maximally overdetermined system, which is maybe a better phrasing, it's more expressive. So you need to add, I repeat, more and more equations to the system so that the solutions are the smallest possible set. In particular, generically, they are given by a finite dimensional vector space outside of the singularities. We were speaking also about Fuchsian ODEs, and there is a general notion of a regular holonomic D-module. And we were speaking about local systems. I already told you that local systems are not enough. You need also to consider some data attached to the singular points. And the correct generalization in higher dimension is the notion of a constructible sheaf. Constructible sheaf means that you can find analytic stratification of your manifold. So then you have a complex of sheaves, and you call it constructible, attached to the stratification, if its cohomology is locally constant on the strata. And then, of course, the complex gives you also some absolutely non-trivial gluing conditions from one stratum to the other. And in particular, there are some very nice constructible sheaves, which are called perverse sheaves. They form an abelian category. They form a stack. And they are very interesting. Okay, so I propose, not me, but let's say Kashiwara proposed to do this replacement. Instead of speaking about Fuchsian ordinary differential operators, consider regular holonomic D-modules. Instead of speaking about local systems, consider constructible sheaves. Okay, so if this is the setting, then I already explained that it is better to work in the derived categories because you need to take into account higher cohomology of the solution complex. So I will denote by dbdx the bounded derived category of left D-modules. Of course, be careful that D is a non-commutative ring. Left and right is not the same. They are equivalent, but let me fix left D-modules. Then I denote by dbcx the bounded derived category of sheaves, and these are sheaves of C-vector spaces. And the theorem by Kashiwara back in 84, so quite a long time after the original formulation of Riemann, but it is a wide generalization, I repeat, so now we are in several variables, we consider systems, is the following diagram. The most interesting thing is the bottom line. This is an equivalence, but also there are some other interesting information. So on the top, I'm simply explaining that the functor I'm considering from left to right is the solution functor that I wrote before. So you take a D-module and you associate to it D-linear morphisms with values in the sheaf of holomorphic functions. The vertical lines are simply embedding, not the indices. So when I put an index, I mean that, for example, in this case, I consider complexes of left D-modules whose cohomologies are holonomic, which means maximally overdetermined. By RH, I do not mean Riemann-Hilbert, I mean Riemann regular holonomic. So this is the equivalent of a Fuchsian operator. And by...
Are there really regular holonomic modules, or just it's a subcategory?
No, so again, each time that there is an index, it means that the complex has cohomologies satisfying the property which is written. So it's complexes of the modules whose cohomology are coherent, holonomic, and regular. And the same here, so these are complexes of C vector spaces whose cohomologies are locally constant along a suitable analytic stratification. And the stratification can depend on the cohomology degree. It's absolutely free. I don't fix the stratification. Okay, so I was saying the vertical arrows are just the embeddings because I add some requirement to the object. The diagonal arrow here is already interesting on its own. It's a previous result by Kashiwara. I forgot the date, but it claims that if you start from a holonomic system of PDEs and you take the complex of solutions, then this is a constructible complex. You don't have that many solutions. That's what is meant by maximally overdetermined. If the system is maximally overdetermined, the solutions are finite dimensional, in a sense. But the content of the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence is that if you add the Fuchsian condition, the regularity condition, then solutions give an equivalence between the two categories. And the interest of this correspondence is that you have a perfect pairing between some kind of algebraic or analytic data, which are the systems of PDEs, and topological data, which is just a constructible complex. I should mention that maybe 10 years, I forgot the dates, I'm sorry, but before, this result already Deligne established a Riemann-Hilbert correspondence in several variables where he did not consider the modules, instead he considered flat meromorphic connections with the regular singularities along the singular divisor. Connections are a particular kind of demodules, I forgot to tell you, but let us say if you take even an ODE, then you can reduce it to a system of first order, and the system of first order gives you, in local coordinates, a connection. So connections are a particular kind of demodules, and if you consider the solutions of this connection, which is the same as the solution of the associated demodule outside of the singular set, then the constructible complex boils down to a local system, and a celebrated result by Deligne established an equivalence between, I repeat, flat regular meromorphic connections and local systems outside of the singular locus. And I should also mention that there is a almost contemporary statement by Mebcut on the equivalence of regular holonomic demodules and C-constructible sheaves, but his technique is not the one I'm going to use, and his result is less deep than the one by Kashiwara, because Kashiwara gives also an explicit reconstruction functor. So if you start from a constructible complex, you can cook up a regular holonomic demodule, let us say explicitly, which gives back your constructible complex by taking solutions. And I should also mention that since I spoke about perverse sheaves, inside as a full subcategory of this one sits the category of perverse sheaves. And perverse sheaves appear in the book by Bellinson, Bernstein, Deligne, and maybe there is also a hidden Gabber in the picture. But the notion of perversity was already found implicitly by Kashiwara, exactly studying the solutions of regular holonomic demodules, because inside here sits another very simple subcategory, which is the category of modules. These are complexes that sit in degree zero. And through this equivalence, if you restrict yourself to modules, you get exactly the perverse sheaves over C on the right-hand side. Okay, I was mentioning that Kashiwara was also able to give an explicit reconstruction functor. And the reconstruction functor goes as follows. So if you take a regular holonomic module, of course, you associate to it its solution complex, but let me call it F to be shorter. And starting from F, you can do this strange business that I'm going to explain in the next slide. So there is a strange complex called the complex of tempered holomorphic solutions, which is quite a contradiction, because if it's holomorphic, it cannot really be tempered, but I will explain. And so if you pair your constructible complex with this strange gadget, you recover your system N. This is not exactly the formulation that Kashiwara gave in 84. In 84, he was able to describe this full packet without pointing out the complex OXT. This gadget, OXT, was introduced by Kashiwara and Shapira in 2001. I prefer to explain straight things in this language, because this complex will be very important for us later in our generalization to the case where modules are not necessarily regular. Okay? So let me concentrate a bit on this gadget that allows you to reconstruct the D-module starting from the constructible complex. So in our paper, we use the language of end sheaves, again introduced by Kashiwara and Shapira in 2001, but maybe for exposition purposes it is better to speak about subanalytic sheaves, which are a particular case. Of course, I got inspiration from a talk on the same subject by Kashiwara. I agree with him that it's easier to digest. I prefer end sheaves, but these are easiest to explain. So what is a subanalytic sheaf? I first introduced a Grothendieck protopology, site. So X was our complex manifold. I change the topology on X. And we decide, they decide, that subanalytic, only subanalytic subset, open subanalytic subsets are to be considered as open subsets. So subanalytic is a very nice category of subsets introduced by Hironaka, and it satisfies lots of very nice properties. Subanalytic subsets are stable by locally finite intersections, by complements, and it's quite easy to describe them at least implicitly, because they contain all images of proper morphisms. So if you take a proper morphism of analytic manifolds, then the image is subanalytic, and then you can construct all the category by taking locally finite intersections and complements. Okay, but for us, we restrict to open, and open in the subanalytic site means open subanalytic. Then if I want a Grothendieck pretopology, I need to tell you what are the covers, and we decide that covers are usual covers, so open covers, but they should be locally finite, not so many. Yes, one of the properties of subanalytic subset is that, for example, they only have finitely many connected components. They are very well behaved. Okay, so if you do this, then you can consider, of course, the category of sheaves on this site. It simply means that it is a pre-sheaf, so a contravariant functor from the category of open subanalytic subset into C-vector spaces, and the descent condition is the usual one, but you require that it holds only for locally finite covers. Okay? So I should mention also Luca Prelli, who studied subanalytic sheaves in details. They already appeared in this paper by Kashiwara and Shapira on end sheaves, but there, they are only a tool to construct some special end sheaves, and Luca Prelli studied the theory in details. Yes?
In the Gauss situation, starting from algebraic variety of Zariski topology, and you go to the analytic, does it factor via this topology?
You can.
Zariski open sets, are they subanalytic?
Yes. Okay, and moreover, they are related to usual sheaves in the transcendental analytic topology, because since I just asked that there are less open subsets, there is a natural morphism of site from the usual complex analytic space to this, and through this map by direct image, you can think a restriction, you have a natural morphism from usual sheaves to subanalytic sheaves. And actually, this category of subanalytic sheaves is very well behaved. You can consider the derived category, and you have the language of six operations here. You need to be a little bit careful because some of the operations are not compatible with this map. So a nice idea to keep track of this fact is to change name. For example, here you have the proper direct image functor. It is not compatible with the companion operation here, so you change notation, you put a double exclamation, and then there is some other, also the om functor is not the same, so you put an I in front, coming from end sheaves, so, okay, I will explain maybe later, and also what's maybe even more important, the colimit is not compatible here, so you put quotes here. This is a typographical trick, but I can explain the substance. I will in a second. Okay, what I want to say also maybe is that I already mentioned a couple of times end sheaves. It can be proved, and it is proved in that reference, that you can reconstruct this category as the category of end objects with values in the category of constructible sheaves. These are just R constructible, which means the cohomology, there is no cohomology, they are constant along a subanalytic stratification, no longer complex here. You take compactly supported, and if you take end objects of these, it's another way of describing. So you can realize subanalytic sheaves as inductive in the limits of our constructible usual sheaves. And we will see an example soon. Okay, so more generally, you can speak about in sheaves dropping this condition. Okay.
Yes.
It's coming. So first example of an in sheaf or subanalytic sheaf, which is not an usual sheaf, is the subanalytic sheaf of tempered distributions. So we will need to be careful about growth conditions when going to the regular case of these. Tempered distributions do not make sense as usual sheaves because you lose temperedness when you restrict to open subsets, but you can keep track of those here. And they are simply defined, so DB denotes the sheaf of Schwarz distributions, usual Schwarz distributions. If I take the image of globally defined distributions into an open subset, what I mean is that DBT on U is the set of distributions on U that can be extended all over, okay? And so this is a first example of a non-trivial example of a subanalytic sheaf, which is really a subanalytic sheaf. If you remember, you can push forward and pull back from usual sheaves to end sheaves by direct and inverse image. If you pull back this sheaf as a usual sheaf, you recover usual distributions. You lose the growth condition. This is the first example of an end sheaf, and it will be very useful for us because out of this, you can construct the complex that was mentioned on the previous slide of tempered holomorphic functions. This is a complex. It is, as usual, when you have distributions, you can construct holomorphic functions by taking the Dolbeau complex. Just be careful that in this setting, the Poincaré lemma does not hold. It is really a complex. It is not an object concentrated in degree zero. But it makes sense. Okay? So this is what I was mentioning in the previous slide. And if you want to have an idea of how this complex works, of course, Keshivara told us that it is the good gadget to reconstruct. And so the first example will not astonish you. If you take a divisor in X, for example, and if you consider the constant sheaf on the complementary of the divisor, I denote by this the extension by zero, then if you take morphisms of this sheaf with values in this new gadget, OXT, you recover the sheaf of holomorphic functions with poles along a divisor. And this is an example. If you take x equal to c, the sheaf of functions with poles, for example, at zero, is an example of a D-module attached to a Fuchsian differential operator, z dz minus 1, right? Okay, so this should not be astonishing because we were supposed to be able to recover. But there is another interesting example. If you take, for example, M, which sits inside of X, since this is not a complex gadget, you can do it distribution. You see, it's related to the subanalytic, so real thing. If you take M inside of X with, such that X is a complexification, think of R to the N into C to the N, then you can do the same business. You take, okay, this is technical, you take the dual, but just to have some shift, into this, and what you find is exactly the sheaf of Schwarz distributions. So note that if you forget the T here, you would get the sheaf of, you would get the sheaf of Sato's hyperfunctions, which are constructed as boundary value of holomorphic functions. And if you put the temperedness condition, then you have some growth condition on wedges and you recover distributions. Okay, so it's a very, very useful gadget, and we will need it. Yes?
Here it seems to indicate that these group distributions are the subsheaf of temperate, well, behave like holomorphic sheaves in some sense, because you do it to a Bok complex of them?
So there are two different things. Distributions are a real, something real that you can do also on real analytic manifolds, no need to have a complex structure. Then when you take the Dolbo complex, this plays the role of holomorphic functions, yes, but tempered. Maybe I did not understand the question. Okay. So now that we have at our disposal this new gadget, we can try to use it. And Kashiwara Shapira already tried in, maybe not in the same paper later, you can consider not holomorphic solutions, but tempered holomorphic solution. So is it more interesting than usual solution? Yes, they are. So take a typical example of non-Fuchsian ODE. This corresponds to, the solutions corresponds to e power 1 over z. So you have an essential singularity, an irregular singularity at the origin of the complex line. And then you can take tempered holomorphic solutions. And what you find is these limits in quotes. If you draw a picture, what you find is the following. So you are on the complex plane, and you are taking the complement of a disk which is tangent to the imaginary line at the origin. And as C grows, the disk shrinks. Okay? So if you take out the quotes, you take the usual inductive limit. If you do the usual inductive limit, you find something which is not so interesting. You simply find the constant sheaf on the complementary of the origin without quotes. But if you keep the quotes, then you keep track of how you are going to this final result. And in particular, you see, even if the disk shrink, what you keep into account is this direction, which is the Stoke line, it's the direction where the exponential grows the fastest, okay? So this new solution complex keeps track of some data coming from the irregularity of the system. Yes?
I'm sorry, so the first two bullet points are about subanalytic sheaves.
Yes.
And the last example is about subanalytic sheaves. Are the middle three,
yes. So this is a subanalytic sheaf.
Ah, so
I'm defining a pre-sheaf first, okay? So as a pre-sheaf, tempered distributions are the image.
Oh, so this isn't
now, if you collect
my father.
Yes. If you take the shiftification of this with the usual topology, you lose the fact that the distributions were extendable, and you find back usual Schwarz distributions. But if you do the shiftification in the new site, then you keep track of the growth condition.
So,
okay. These are, by definition, are sections on an open subset.
Sections of the sheafification. That's what that image, that's what DV sub X of X is.
This is a global distributions on X.
But which is, just one
distributions. There is not T here, sorry. It's a bit.
So where does the sub analytic arrive on that?
When you sheafify, so.
Oh, you first define this pre-sheaf.
This turns out to be already a sheaf, but only for the subanalytic topology.
Oh, okay.
Okay? It is only a pre-sheaf for the usual topology, and if you sheafify, you lose. Okay? Welcome. And I should mention that our chairman, Giovanni Morando, went on studying this kind of gadget, and in particular he was able to prove that in this way, if you start from any holonomic system, you find something which is R-constructible in a suitable sense. Okay. But maybe if you are really optimistic, you... I'm 10 minutes late. If you are really optimistic, you could hope that this is the good gadget to recover not necessarily regular system. It is not, because if you look here, if you take exponential 1 over z or 2 over z, the systems are cofinal, they give the same result, you cannot distinguish. But they are not at all isomorphic as the modules. So you need something more. In order to, maybe I will go quickly, but in order to tell you what are the problems, let me recall what is known already in dimension 1, in one dimension, about irregular ODEs. So an irregular ODE, take a point which is a singularity, Z0, but not necessarily Fuchsian. And then we know something about solutions, but at the formal level, so if around Z0, you need first a ramification. After a suitable ramification, a basis of formal solutions is a little bit like before. There is a ramification, but there is also an exponential, and the exponent is polynomial in negative powers. So this is, goes back to Huquara level, Turitin, classical stuff. You can be not only formal, but you can describe analytic solutions, but you can do it only asymptotically on directions. So if you take a direction theta going out of your singular point, so pick so you have W equal to 0, you pick a direction theta, what you can do is take a small enough sector around this direction, and on that sector you can prove that there exists an asymptotic, there exists an analytic solution on the sector which is asymptotic to the given formal solution. And there is however, a problem which is at the origin of the Stokes phenomenon, if you take solutions attached to another exponent, and if the real part of the new exponent is smaller than the real part of your exponent at the direction, then you see that the analytic extension is not at all unique. There are some hidden components, and they appear out of nowhere when you cross a Stokes direction. This is the problem of irregularity. Already yesterday, Philip Bolch was speaking about this kind of irregular Riemann-Hilbert correspondence in dimension 1 when he was speaking about Stokes G-local systems, and he already told us that you need to add some more topological information if you want to be able to reconstruct things. He was speaking at the level of connections. I'm going to speak at the level of the modules. Okay. So, using this Huquara level Turitin result, Deligne and Malgrange in the 80s were able to produce a full Riemann-Hilbert correspondence for D modules in dimension one. The problem is that they had to fix the singular locus, because I'm not going into details, but if you want to describe their target category, it is an ad hoc construction. As Philip was doing yesterday, you need to take the real blow-up around singularities, and so you construct a new space out of the singularities. It does not hold in general. It's not singularity-free. You need to fix some data. And then you need to use other ideas in order to keep track of this Stokes phenomenon. Roughly speaking, they take some ordering according to the exponents in such a way that when you go to the graded part, this analytification becomes unique. But I don't go into the detail. What is clear to me, at least, is that it is really difficult to extend this in higher dimension. Claude Sabat recently wrote a book where he explains how to go in higher dimensions, but with some limits, in the sense that he can treat only what are called good meromorphic connections, and again, he has to fix the singular divisor in order to be able to do it. Okay, but in order to treat the general case, we introduce some new notions, which we call the enhanced sheaves, or maybe better, enhanced subanalytic sheaves. And the idea is as follows. So you add one variable. I will explain later why it's maybe a good idea to do it. Well, first, because it works, but also maybe philosophically. So if I consider what we call a bordered subanalytic site, in the sense that now we consider, again, subanalytic subsets, but which are subanalytic up to a compactification of the real line. So you take the compactification by adding one point at infinity, and again, only locally finite covers. So this is a new site that keeps into account the... so we will see, we already saw when we dealt with the example of e power 1 over x, that we will have to consider things like limit for c going to infinity of constant shift, let us say, of t bigger or equal than c, or smaller than c, whatever you want, say smaller than c, we found smaller than c. So if you consider this kind of shifts on the real line, if you take the usual subanalytic topology, this is a trivial shift, you don't see anything at infinity, but if you take this new subanalytic topology, border topology, this is non-trivial. Okay, so this is the first idea. And we give a definition which is influenced by the recent work of Tamarkin on symplectic topology. I will not have time to explain what's the link. But we define a new category, which we call the category of enhanced n-sheaves. So you take sheaves with one variable more, and then you quotient out by things which are locally constant along the fibers of the projection. Okay, why not? It is a very nice category. It is a commutative tensor category. The tensor product is given by convolution. So if you have R infinity square, you have three maps into R infinity, which are the first and second projection and sum. Mu is just the sum. Mu of T1, T2 is T1 plus T2. So of course, if you pull back and then push forward, this is the usual convolution, like for the integrals. And the unit is the delta function, so the constant shift at the origin. This category is called the category of enhanced shifts because, okay, sorry, first I forgot this line. So it is a nice category because it has the usual six operations. Be careful that now the tensor is the convolution, and the OM is the adjoint of the convolution. And then you have the other, this is the problem that I already mentioned before. We use this notation simply to point out that it is not compatible with the usual operation. But it is a left adjoint to the extraordinary pullback. So, okay, you have the six operations. It is enhanced sheaves, because usual sheaves sit inside. There is a canonical way of taking a sheaf and putting it inside this new cartridge. It is fully faithful. Okay. Now, why is it a good cartridge to deal with irregular holonomic modules? Let me give an example. A typical example of an irregular holonomic module is an exponential module, and I will show you how it is possible to reconstruct exponential modules inside this cartridge. So, addition.
Yeah.
Convolution.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe it's not easy to read. The light is not. We should change the system. Yeah. Stupid. This. Okay, I cannot. I discovered that I cannot read on the left hand side because they put a red line. Just. Okay, sorry. Anyway, it's convolution. So let me introduce the sheaf of enhanced tempered distributions. It's the usual tempered distribution, so we are always in a subanalytic context, and it takes solution of E to dt. Okay. This is just a sheaf, not a complex. And then, of course, I can take the Dolbeau complex of this one. I call it enhanced tempered holomorphic function. There is a shift which is a technical point. I don't enter into this fact. Forget it if you want, because reconstruction will work anyway. But so now we can consider enhanced solutions of the module. And roughly speaking, what you're doing, you're taking solutions with one variable more, and you take the exterior product. So this is quite a simple-minded functor. You add e to dt in the extra variable. Okay. First, we prove a theorem which generalizes the example that was given in a few slides ago. If you consider the exponential module, you should be careful. Exponential module means the D module generated by E to D phi, but you add poles along the divisor. This is a technical point, but it's important. Okay, this is my definition of E to D phi. Anybody's definition of E to D phi in the sense of D modules. And if you take enhanced solution, then you find exactly something similar to what we found before. So you see that the real part of phi so comes into the picture, and this takes into account the growth of the exponential. And there is, again, this quoted limit, which would be absolutely uninteresting without the quotes. But with the quotes, you keep into account the growth of the exponential. OK, this is the first result. So we know how solutions are described. And the second result is that from this, you can reconstruct your D module, your irregular D module. So and, okay, Aram, I don't enter into the details, and this was inspired by a work of mine on the Laplace transform of tempered holomorphic functions. So at least if you start with the toy model of an exponential D module, everything works well. You can reconstruct. Fortunately, we can lean on very deep work by Mochizuki and Kedlaya. Recently, they described quite explicitly the structure of general irregular meromorphic connections. And we use their result as a kind of black box. For those who were here last week, Francesco Bottacin explained to us how difficult it is to describe the notion of good wild harmonic bundles in the sense of Mochizuki. So it's better to really to use it as a black box. In our case, the black box is the following. So let us say that you have any statement about a holonomic D module, for example, reconstruction, that you can reconstruct. If the statement is local, so you can check it on an open cover, if it is stable by shift and it is additive by distinguished triangles, so something very natural in this assumption. If it is stable by direct summons, okay, this is okay, for those who were here last week, or also in the previous slides, you know, you need to take ramification. So when you take ramification, it's important to understand that you should be stable by direct summand. And if you are stable by projective direct images, and this is also important because when you want to describe the things like Mochizuki or Kedlaya, you need to take modifications of your original manifold. So you need to be able to keep track also of this part. Finally, if you know that your result holds in some special case, then you're done. Okay? And this special case, what is called normal form, means exactly, roughly speaking, that you are dealing with exponential modules. So roughly speaking, of course, it's 100 pages work, I'm cheating a bit, but if you know to do it for exponentials, you know how to do it. Okay, and since we did it for exponentials, we did it, and we can state now our Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, which states the following. So consider the factor of enhanced solution from holonomic modules to this new category of enhanced sheaves. Then the solutions are constructible in a very natural sense. Constructible here means that, so remember that you have your projection from the additional variable, you forget the additional variable, and a complex K in this new category is R constructible if for each open subset on the base X there exists a usual constructible sheaf, really a sheaf, not a usual constructible sheaf, such that at least locally on U, so in taking the tensor with pi minus 1 of U means that I'm looking only at U, not U, but U, is just the, just, okay, I prefer to go on with, this is a technical thing, but it's just a constructible sheaf, okay? This is the way of embedding, okay, it's just a constructible sheaf on X times R. Okay, it is constructible and you can reconstruct. And you can summarize this in this diagram. Such construction is compatible with the usual Kashiwara construction. On the bottom row, I copied the usual Riemann-Hilbert correspondence for regular holonomic modules. You take tempered solution and you reconstruct through the complex of tempered holomorphic functions. On the top row, our new construction. So we are able to say that if you start with holonomic, you find constructible. And then you can take the enhanced solutions and you reconstruct. Okay? So the vertical arrows are fully faithful embeddings. So our correspondence extends the usual one. There are some other problems. This is not the end. We were not able to describe explicitly the essential image of the solution functor. It would be very nice, because if we had a nice topological description of the image, downstairs you see the answer is being C constructible. Upstairs being R constructible is not enough. We need to be more precise. So it would be interesting to describe the essential image in order to have an equivalence here. And it would also be very interesting to do the same business for perverse sheaves, which means you take the natural T structure here, what does it give on the right-hand side? We were not yet able to answer this question.
Is there an index missing on the right, on top, for the reconstruction? No, the category on the right.
Here? No, because, as I said, this is not the essential image. So if you start from this, which is bigger than the image, you do not, you find something that are not even coherent. You find the D-module, so you keep the D-module structure, but so if you start from down here, you reconstruct. But if you start from the middle, it's too big. So, no, it's not a mistake, it's on purpose. It's a limit of what, okay? And, okay, maybe in 5 minutes that are left, I spoke about the Stokes phenomenon. How is the Stokes phenomenon encoded topologically in our construction? So I can give you a simple example. So Stokes phenomenon appears when there are two exponentials interacting. So let us go back to dimension one and take two meromorphic functions with poles at the origin. Then to the exponential d-module is associated enhanced solution that I described. I just copied what was written on the previous slide. Okay, so this is a limit taking into account the growth, so there is the real part of phi. Then take a flat meromorphic connection, which is a d-module which is very well behaved on the singularity. You can understand how it is described just okay, take a flat meromorphic connection, sorry, I'm speaking too much. And then assume that for each direction coming out of zero, this d-module really decomposes, I don't enter into the details what it means, this tilde, but let us assume that direction after direction, like in the Hukuara Turitin leveled result, this d-module is simply a direct sum of the two exponential modules. Okay, so now when the direction theta moves around, this isomorphism will change, and when you cross a Stokes lines, something drastic will appear. I want to recover this phenomenon from the topological point of view, which means out of the enhanced solution complex of M. So since you have this decomposition, at the level of enhanced solutions, something similar happens, which means that around each direction theta, this solution complex decomposes as the direct sum of the two components. And are we able to find the Stokes phenomenon, so in particular the Stokes matrices, out of just of this topological picture? Yes, as follows. So let me just recall what the Stokes line. You take the locus of zeros of the real part of the difference. This is, if you are small enough around the origin, this is a union of curves. Take the tangent curves, take the tangents to the curves at the origin. These are the Stokes lines. And you can prove a lemma, which is the following. If you take an open sector around a given direction, as before in the Fukuhara level Turitin picture, so you have your small sector around the direction, then if you consider endomorphisms of this sheaf here, the result depends on the sector. So if you localize on an open sector, you get upper or lower triangular matrices if you are in a sector completely contained. This should be bigger than zero. This is a mistake. Okay. So according to the real part being positive or negative, you find upper or lower triangular matrices. And if your sector contains exactly one Stokes line, not the others, then you find diagonal matrices. Okay? And so these are the when you want to, you can reconstruct K out of its restrictions on sectors, where you know how it behaves, and the glue-in matrices are exactly the Stokes matrices.